message should lead you with a contrite heart to the table and should prepare you. I want to read a verse from 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21. I'm going to read it. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us. Once again, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is one of the most beautiful verses in the Bible. Theologians call this the heart of the gospel. It is the gospel in one verse. Everything you need to know to go to heaven is given in a concise form in these words. How important is this verse? It is such important that if you miss this, you miss the whole truth of God about salvation. But if you get it right, even if you get so many other things wrong, you will go to heaven. That means this is the pathway that leads us to heaven, salvation. And because this the meaning of this word, the understanding of his words will lead us to heaven, the thought comes to our lives, there is heaven and there is hell, and hell is left. Why do we need a salvation? We need a salvation because none of us want to go to hell. Salvation is salvation from hell, at the same time admittance to heaven. Every single being, human being on earth, they have in their inner heart the feeling where I will get lost, or I will be saved. Will I go to heaven or I will end up in hell? When we are together, we don't have much thought of that. But when we are alone, this is the one that haunts, that confronts us all the time. It used to be, in my childhood, this particular thought was always with me. That there is hell, there is heaven. Where will I go? How can I go to heaven? What will lead me to heaven? And actually, in those days, we used to recite something saying that Asadoma Sadgamaya, Murtyoma Amrutam Gamaya, that is Sanskrit, that's Malayalam. It is from darkness lead me to light, from death lead me to life. So that was my desire, my longing, my whole prayer, one particular thing I was confronting all the time. If you don't think about heaven and hell at this time, if that thought is not in your mind, as you get older, you will be attacked by that thought. In our place, there was a very, 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 very cruel police officer by name Pulikodan. That is his name, Pulikodan Narayan. Pulikodan means the man, that is how he is known. He is known to torture every culprit that he arrests. And he was behind very famous prison deaths. He is a very cruel person. But when he retired, one thought gripped his heart. How can he get away from the sin that he has committed? What will lead him to eternal life? And he became a Hindu monk. What led him? He's the most cruel person we know of. But we know of in our place. If you say Pulikodan Narayanan, people will shudder for a moment. Such cruel he was. Such fierce was his attacks on a particular group of people. The thing is, the thought of heaven is always nagging on you and me. So salvation, the thought of salvation is very important, and this particular verse is the clue that will take you to heaven. It says, this is the heart of the gospel. What is gospel? Gospel is a good news. And what is the good news? the news that will take you out of hell and place you into heaven. And the good news is that there is somebody who has paid for even debt that you owe to the Lord, paid the debt of your sin, and he rescues from hell so that you can go to heaven through him. Jesus Christ paid our debt. We are sinners, we were sinners. We still live in a sinful body. Sin has a hold on us. Every moment sin talks to you. Sin comes in the form of some impressive things the other people are doing, thinking that I could also do and be a hero. Sin is always calling you to participate in some kind of a sinful act. So sin is there on your path all the time, enticing you, trying to lead you into destruction. So you need a savior. And how can you get saved? When you are a sinner, you are indebted to God because the wages of sin is that any person who commits sin is destined to go to eternal damnation, which is eternal death. But salvation is the salvation from hell. But the Lord doesn't excuse sin. That is a very bad thing. Our parents excuse us sin. My people, sometimes I have seen, I was thinking all day today, some people who excuse certain things because they get some benefits. I could be very serious about some sins, but if you provide me with some kind of a thing, that will make me excuse. Sometimes I will close my eyes, saying that I am not so talking about mine, what I will do. I'm very unlikely to do that. You will see a serious person when you confront me with that kind of things. If certain people, if they are paid a certain amount of money, they will probably close their eyes towards sin. They will say, it's okay, well, don't worry about it. Everybody sins. Everybody sins, I sin, you sin, and we all sin. Don't worry about it. There is nothing serious in that. That is what we are told. But the Lord doesn't excuse sin. Is that true? The Lord doesn't excuse sin. He will punish, and he is punishing sin in the world. He will not excuse it. He has to have the price paid, either by me or by somebody else. But since I am a sinner, you cannot pay for my sin. A sinner cannot pay for my sins. Because he himself is a debtor. You owe him your life to God, and then you cannot stand and pledge it on my behalf, saying, Lord, I will pay for him, because the Lord will look at you and say, you owe me your life. How can you pay for his life? So we need a savior who doesn't owe the Almighty God anything at all. Nobody was found. From creation till the day the Lord Jesus came to the world, all the saints and wicked men, whoever lived on the face of the earth, they were all sinners. Not a single righteous person was there. All the sacrifices in the Old Testament times was imperfect. None of them could satisfy the Lord, saying that, Lord, I'm going to offer a sacrifice. It was only a momentary satisfaction. It was only for the Day of Atonement that the sacrifice was good. It was not good for all the time. So we were all lost in sin. And we needed a Savior. The Savior should be perfect. There should not be any blemish in his life. Nobody could point their finger at that person saying that you are not fit. Because the Lord loved the world so much that he did not like me getting lost in hell, he said, I will come and take the home of Radhan and everyone over here, and I will pay the price for you, so that if you will believe in me and you will accept me, accept what I do on your behalf. If you will accept me, he's not saying, Lord, I accept you. No, it is you accept what the Lord is doing on your behalf on the cross, that you say, the Lord is paying my price, the price that I owe to God, and he is the fittest person, he is the perfect sacrifice, perfect victim that could pay my price. He is the perfect sacrifice who could satisfy the Lord's requirement that sin be judged. The Lord doesn't excuse sin. Sin must be judged. That is the law of the Lord. And if he excuses the law in a few people's behalf, then the Lord becomes a liar. If I create a law and I excuse a particular group of people when they commit the crime, I become a respecter of person. Then you will say he is not good. He excused that guy, but he did not excuse this guy. The Lord, when he sets the rule, he sets it for, and he sets it that it has to be satisfied. Sin must be judged, and that is why the Lord had to come to this world. Think about sin for a moment. How serious the Lord Almighty takes the fact of sin in our life. He said, even if I have to come and die on the cross, the cruel death on the cross, sin has to be paid for. Sin has to be paid for. Sin has to be judged, because he has decreed what the wages of sin is. That it has to be paid for by the death of a perfect victim. The only person available was Almighty God. He loved me so much, so he took the form of man, me in my form. He came and he died for me on the cross of Calvary. And that is what we read. He made him who knew no sin. You read that Bible verse again, 21. Him who knew no sin, he made sin on my behalf. Jesus Christ did not know sin at all, but the Almighty God took all my sin and he put it on himself. It is not that he is casting on a third party. It is easy to kill another animal for my behalf, but it is very difficult that I say, I will die for your sin. That is what the Lord did. He took all my sin. He said, I love you so much. I don't ever want you to be in hell, because hell is such a price that you will suffer all eternity. It is not for 100 years. It is not for a million years. It is for all the time. And the rich man says, I am in agony. I long, somebody help me, to have a drop of water over here. I am in flames. I don't want my brothers to come over here. What do people do when they suffer? Somebody, they got somebody else saying that, let him also taste, right? Right? What do you do when you are in real trouble and somebody is walking by? What a man does. A man doesn't go and bite everyone so that they all will get mad. Evil people always want the other person to experience the trouble that he is experiencing. And his thought is, let him also. No, that is in mind, in the mind and in your mind. We will say, oh, let the whole world enjoy. But if you are not enjoying, you will say, and that is what we read in Psalms 73. The psalmist will say, everybody else is enjoying, and I am struggling. I wash my hands in innocence for nothing, but the whole world should struggle as I do. That is what they are told to us. But Almighty God said, no, none should die. None should go to hell. Hell is such a bad place that none of you should go. Then, if you don't listen to what the Lord has done, he has made the Lord Jesus, the one person who did not have any sin, he made the Almighty God, made himself sin for me. He took my sin and he suffered for my sins on the cross, paid for the price. He set me free, and he is asking me to follow him, to accept what the Lord has done.